Miss March, another letter has arrived for you. Miss March.
Mrs. Kirk, the mutton you ordered is on the kitchen table. Oh, hello, Professor. Another letter. Another rejection?
I have no idea. I do not read your letters, but they keep arriving and I keep bringing them to you.
I just keep hoping that maybe
someday...
We all
keep hoping for your success, Miss March. You have the entire boarding house on edge.
My dear Miss March, I read your story. Well, he's read it. Unfortunately, I found your tale tasteless and vulgar, not at all suitable for my readers. And my advice to you...
My advice to you is to return home and have babies. This is what women are made for. Sincerely, F. Putnam.
22 rejections since I've been in New York, and they all say the same thing. Go home and give up.
F. Putnam is an idiot. His words are stupid.
F. Putnam is one of the most powerful publishers in the city.
You cannot give up hope, Miss March. Somebody will like your story. I'm sure of it.
Professor, is it possible I could read you one of my stories? There's no one's opinion I would appreciate more.
Yes, of course.
Right. Let's see. Oh, actually, it's one of my best. It was a mean and stormy night. The moors were bleak and bloody. Thunder claps, lightning strikes. The fair Clarissa, her clothes in disarray, races across the wild coastal heath. Now she stops. Now she runs. Will she escape? Will she be caught? With bold determination, the villainous aristocrat Braxton Prendergast lurches for her. There's no escape. She's but a child, and yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze unafraid. She will not be defiled.
Keep away from me, you wretch!
I cannot keep away.
Your beauty draws me.
Your
passion
ignites me.
Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
On the hand of that woman villain, who are you?
I am your destiny, your bitterest foe.
You stole what was rightly mine 10 long years ago. You left me cold, alone, and forgotten. Now I'm back to settle the score.
Miss March! What is it exactly that you are writing here?
Oh, blood and guts stuff. Magazines and periodicals are full of it. It's all the rage.
Violence and seduction on every page?
Well, read history, read Shakespeare, read the newspaper.
It's getting late. Perhaps it is better we pursue this some other time.
No, I want to know your opinion now, Professor.
Miss March, blood and guts stuff? You think that's what the world wants to hear? If I know nothing else about you, I know that you are unique. Something you should try not to forget. I think you can do better.
Better? And who are you, an aging German professor close to 50?
I am 34.
34? Well, you look quite a lot older.
I worry a lot.
Oh, really? And just what about do you worry?
How to avoid a conversation such as this. Now I will go to dinner. Miss March. Since you've been here, what is it, 6 weeks now? You shout, you rant, you disrupt the whole order of this boarding house. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You're aloof, you're arrogant.
Arrogant? Miss March, I spoke my mind as you spoke yours. Clearly, it was not appreciated on the other side.
Obviously, my stories were a great success in Concord. Better, better than what? Better than this dazzling plot. Story will be my King Lear. Each phrase is better, better than him, better even.
dragon and my nose was flat.
Joe, I hate being a governess. I should be meeting eligible young men.
It's going to be a dismal Christmas. What with father away and no money for presents?
Meg, Amy, Joe is a surprise for us.
Or was I better when I was home?
Listen, everyone. I have risen to the occasion and written us an operatic tragedy.
And we're going to perform it for Christmas.
No, I can't! Not with my flat nose!
Joe, do you really think we should with this awful war and everything?
Meg! When have we ever let anything defeat us? Years from now, people will talk about us. One Christmas Eve, four penniless ragged sisters put on an operatic tragedy for all of Concord.
All of Concord?
Full of blood, guts, two massacres, a masked ball, and several heart-wrenching scenes. We'll dim the lights, the crowd will hush. We'll start the overture and Beth will surely blush. But when Clarissa starts to plead, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Joe, do I die again in this one?
Yes. Meg, you will die like none before. The world will shatter when your body hits the floor. When Rodrigo makes you bleed, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams. Now, Amy, as Clarissa, only passion is permissible. The tragedy depends upon the fire in your eyes. And death, when you're the mother, the only noble you'll be pure.
Mother, dear mother, do not cry.
No. Any expression from the heart. Mother, oh no, dear mother, do not cry. Mother, dear mother, Joe, I am teased and ridiculed at school, and all that concerns you is your silly little tragedy. I know you're tired, I know it's hard, but we will triumph when Rodrigo yells on guard.
Today!
Our success is guaranteed. Christmas will be thrilling. Christmas will be gory. Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Joe!
Listen, everyone. I made an important decision today. As you know, I've been writing stories since forever with much satisfaction, and people seem to like what I write.
We love it, Joe.
Absolutely. Who doesn't? But I've decided I'm going to become a world-renowned writer. I shall write great books, earn barrels of money, and give you all everything you have ever dreamed of.
Joe can do anything.
But we must promise. No matter what happens, we will always remain together, solid like a fortress. We must always remain the Four March Sisters. Forever.
Forever!
Come, let's begin.
You have me, or
not my daughter, you wretch!
Mother, dear mother, do not cry!
Before we
Lincoln tonight, another.
I want you to get Annie Moffat to invite me to St. Valentine's Day.
I'll wring her bloody little neck if she doesn't, another.
I want you to get us a Christmas tree.
I'll have Rodrigo chop one down immediately.
Where?
That house across the road.
But that's on Mr. Lawrence's property.
You'll go to prison for it.
A prison? What care I for a prison?
Joe is an incredible human
Look,
being.
It's Mr. Lawrence. He's sitting at the window glaring out.
He looks sinister.
I think he looks sad.
I wouldn't be sad living in such a house.
Has anyone ever been inside?
He'd never let any of us in.
They say he's a very angry and bitter man. Joe's gonna get us all in
known as the family with the criminal sister.
What criminal sister?
Mommy!
Home! What's happening here?
Joe's written us an operatic tragedy.
And she's inviting all of Concord to see us perform in it.
I'm the mother in it, and I die in it, but it's a beautiful death.
And I play Clarissa, who's very sweet.
It sounds wonderful.
Oh, Marmy, it's Joe's best.
Tell us about your day.
Well, we needed socks and blankets for the Soldiers Aid Society, and a letter came from Father.
A letter from Father?
Read it to us, Marmy.
Where's Joe?
She's outside.
Read the letter, Marmy.
We'll wait for Joe.
But she may be ours.
I want to hear all the things you did today.
I
Charlotte Fenton teased me merciless at school. I'd be so humiliated.
Joe!
Rodrigo has returned!
Joe.
Marmy!
Where did you get that tree?
Well, I may have borrowed it from Mr. Lawrence.
Joe, you didn't.
Did it for us, Marmy?
You'll take it back immediately.
But that's like taking a chicken back with its head cut off.
Do let us keep it.
It's Christmas, Marmy.
No, destroying someone else's property.
We could give it to the Hummels. They have so little.
Good. The tree goes to the Hummels then. Now, what about Mr. Lawrence?
What about him?
Mr. Lawrence?
Yes, Mr. Lawrence. You!
Me?
You chopped down my perfect Douglas fir. I should have you arrested!
I'll make it up to you, sir.
With what?
I'll plant 6 more.
12!
And I'll chop your firewood for a few days.
Weeks! And I hope such an incident never happens again. You've ruined my day.
He loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III. But everyone calls me Laurie. I've come to live here. In Concord. I can play the piccolo, I can sleep standing up, and I won a medal in school for holding my breath nearly 3 minutes before passing out. I think that was terrifically daring of you chopping down Grandfather's tree. Well, goodbye.
Theodore Lawrence III? Would you mind delivering that tree to the Hummels?
I don't mind at all.
He doesn't mind.
Just point me in the direction.
1/2 mile down that road, red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Joe, you must think before you act on every whim.
I just wanted us all to have a wonderful Christmas, Marmy.
Joe, a letter's come from Father.
Oh, Christopher Columbus!
You read the letter, Marmy.
My dear wife, the war goes on and on. The end seems nowhere in sight. The days are difficult and long, but I am well.
He's well!
Still, it's very lonely here, away from my dear ones. Especially lonely as Christmas time is approaching. Every night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us!
Send them all my love and give them a sweet kiss. Tell them to be good girls, faithful and hardworking. And to conquer that which is disagreeable in them. So that when I return, I'll be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women. Why are we looking so glum? Do we have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do!
Then there's work to do. We need costumes to complete, and we need an oleo curtain for you to paint.
Oh, Marmy, will you perform something for us?
Do, Marmy.
Oh, yes. Yes, I shall write something thrilling for you with passion and daring.
Yes. Yes, I will. We'll make it the best Christmas ever. We March women are invincible. Now come, let's get to work.
I'll get my paint.
I'll look for a costume for Mom.
I'll design the handbill.
I still don't understand why we couldn't have kept that tree.
My dear husband. Tell you everything is fine. Be attentive to the distance. Send my love every line. Every word should bring you closer and caress you with its tone. Nothing remind you
that I am here alone. I can't tell you what I'm feeling. I can't talk about the war, how the peal of the church bells brings the battle to our door. I don't know which part is harder, what I know or what's unknown. Raising little women while I am here alone. Counting days,
Josephine.
Good morning, Aunt March.
Do you know the hour?
Almost 10, I believe.
Your workday with me begins at 9. You missed reading to me, and still have yet to repair the latch on the cellar door.
Well, I'm sorry, Aunt March. I got distracted finding you this beautiful flower.
Do not trifle with me, Josephine. You were dawdling.
I was not dawdling. I was writing a story.
You're what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never here when you need him. And now my nephew has the audacity to become an army chaplain when he can barely even support his own family. Josephine, listen to me. You are on the verge of womanhood.
Oh, Christopher Columbus.
And just look at you. You go around writing stories, constantly trying to save the world when you can barely even save yourself.
I don't need saving.
Josephine, there are many pitfalls a girl could fall into, and you are heading towards every one of them. I want to see you shine. Even if you're not rich, you can marry well.
I'll never marry.
You'll marry all girls marry.
Well, I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage comes power. You could take your place in society.
Well, I don't give two figs about society.
Then I don't see the point in our having this conversation. It is clear to me now I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe.
It was an idle thought of mine.
And March, do you have any idea how important it is for a writer to travel? It's my dream.
We earn our dreams in this world, Josephine. It was foolish of me to think you could ever change your ways.
I could try.
not you.
Well, I could change if I wanted to.
Could you practice self-control? Could you possibly be shy? Could you wear a corset tight in the heat of mid-July? There are things you must obey, everyone which you defy. You'll never change. You won't. That's why. And travel very far indeed. You could be a Kylie.
Charming niece?
Someone well-mannered, a model of grace. Learn the art of smiling.
That could be hard.
It isn't very hard for someone full of dreams like you. If you work, you'll find there's nothing too.
So if I change, we'll go to Paris.
Change completely or don't waste my time.
If I change, we'll stop in Antwerp.
Gracious living will treat you sublime.
If I change, you'll take me to Zurich.
Every city from Dublin to Cologne.
Surely with your guidance, I could learn to use feminine wiles with you.
Charm a donkey for a chance to see the world. Learn the art of smiling. I could button up my mind and keep my thoughts perfumed and pearled. Yes, I surely think I could.
If you could, that would be good.
There is nothing that I wouldn't suffer to see.
I try, I can do it by sheer will.
All you have to do is work to acquire any skill.
These are things a girl must do when she has dreams she must fulfill.
Change how you walk and how you talk and how you think and how you are.
I'll hold my breath, I'll hold my tongue, do what it takes to travel far.
Could you?
Good.
Girls, it's getting quite late. Wait till you see them, Barbie. I think my two oldest daughters will be attending their first ball.
You, Beth?
Me? You think so? I can't go.
Meg! Meg, why not?
Go. Look at me. Every girl in the Concord has been to this ball and my age, and this is the very first time I've worn a dress like this, anything like this.
I wore that very same dress to my first ball, and it didn't look half as good on me. Margaret March, you've been dreaming about Annie Moth and St. Valentine's Day ball for months. You can't walk away from it now.
I'm not built for gowns.
You look very alluring.
I think the part you're thinking of is alarming, Marmee. Oh, look at Meg. She's the beauty here. She'll be the most sought-after girl at the ball.
She doesn't want to go.
What?
What if someone asked to dance with me?
Just smile and say, I'd be delighted.
Delighted.
Then offer him your hand.
Delighted.
Delighted. Now let him take command.
I'm hardly delighted.
You're dancing like a candle.
No, I cannot dance tonight.
I'd be delighted.
Then you go. The music is entrancing.
Exotic. The sound of my voice. know?
I found this old dress and it almost fits.
It was mine.
I know. All it needs is a pretty sash. Besides, why shouldn't I go?
Because you weren't invited.
I can go in your place.
In my place?
You don't care about good society, and I do.
I don't care about snobs. People who think they're better than us just because they live in grander houses.
They do have grander houses.
Nothing.
But I want elegance and fine things, Marmee.
And I want passion. I want to be noticed because I'm unique, not because of some silly sash.
Sashes aren't silly. Aunt March says the right accessories could be the key to a girl's success. Besides, I wouldn't go to a ball with scorch marks on the back of my dress.
Amy, stop
it! As big as your...
Beth, get my sewing basket.
Jo hates balls. She should just stay in her musty little attic and write her dreadful little
Amy!
Stories.
My stories aren't dreadful.
Nobody reads them and nobody likes them.
Well, girls! I like them. And I'm sending this one off to a very prominent New York publisher.
And he'll hate it.
Girls! There, Jo. It's barely noticeable.
We've got to go.
Yes. Yes, and I'll tell everyone at the ball how sweet you were to give me this beautiful fan. And Beth, if anyone calls for us, we'll be at the ball. Good night, Marmee.
Good night, everyone.
Have a wonderful evening, girls. Amy, think about what you just said. When Jo gets home, you can apologize. Now come, girls. Let's go to bed. Amy!
Coming.
Elegant, brimming with confidence, and I shall sit grandly. Oh, Christopher Columbus!
Excuse me.
You?
Me?
What are you doing here?
I passed out. Too much dancing, I guess.
Well, too much punch, I'd say.
Laurie! Laurie! Laurie, where have you been? I've been looking everywhere for you.
Mr.
Your grandfather will be furious. Come now, Laurie.
Mr. Brooke,
Sir, you've got my dance card.
Is this yours? Oh, I'm sorry. So, you're Margaret March?
Yes, I am.
It's a splendid party, isn't it?
Yes, quite lovely. So you're from Boston?
Actually, Maine.
Oh, I've never been to Maine.
Well, you should go. It's a beautiful country. Very primitive.
I like primitive.
Really?
Mr. Brooke is a romantic.
Is that true?
Oh, no. I read Keats and Kelly. I mean, Keats and Shelley.
So do I.
Oh, Christopher Columbus.
You read Keats and Shelley?
All the time.
Do you like to dance, Miss March?
Oh, well, Meg, we were just about to join the ladies in the parlor.
I'd be delighted, Miss March. Excuse us, Joe.
Make me beam.
Well, you look ridiculous.
You're looking very fetching tonight.
Fetching? Really?
So tell me, when you're not attending balls, what do you do?
Well, I write blood and gut stories. I create extraordinary plans. I'm going to Europe. Well, Mommy says you're all alone in the world, mother and father. That must be awful for you.
It's not that awful. I've got a cranky old grandfather, and I've got a cat, and well, I was hoping to say...
What?
I was hoping to say you.
Me? You don't have me.
I know I have no right, but sometimes late at night, I watch you in the aisle, pacing back and forth like a maniac. I
I've never met a girl like you, anyone at all like you. This is very nice, such a lovely party. The music sounds so thrilling. It makes a person feel like dancing. I'm very good at it. I won a medal in school for dancing.
Oh, I don't dance. Besides, I've had a patch on the back of my
patch, let me see it.
Oh, no.
Oh, I like it. That patch could start a whole new fashion. If you dance with me tonight, I can guarantee by next spring, every girl in Concord will be wearing a patch on her dress. Could do 100 things, do anything you please. Could fly golden wings across the seven seas. I'll bet you get a camel through a needle if you'll take a chance on me.
Well, you're a lunatic.
Could catch 1,000 stars and send them on a pin. Could leap from here to Mars and make the planet spin. If you want to do other things you've ever dreamed of, come on, take a chance on me. We could be such friends. A medal at school for boxing. Come on now.
Oh, whoa. Oh.
Close one.
All right. Come on.
Oh,
so that's how you can
cheat. Could live beyond dreams. Try me.
I challenge you to a skating race tomorrow at the pond. Come on.
We'll circle the world doing all we ever dreamed of. 'Cause you'll take a chance. Yes, you'll take a chance. Finally take a chance. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
The evening began very strangely, but ended magnificently. Good night.
Good night. Can you walk on it?
It's nothing, Marmee.
Tell us about the ball.
Well, I tried to do all these ladylike things, Marmee, but they went unnoticed, except for Mr. Lawrence's grandson. Oh, poor Meg, no one wanted to dance with her except for that pompous Mr. Brooks.
He danced divinely. I had a wonderful time. Actually, the best time of my life. I may have left here a girl, but I came home a woman.
A woman? What's she talking about? Meg!
It's just Meg being silly, Marmee.
Well, it's been a long day for all of us. Let's get to bed.
My sweet Beth, look at what I brought for you. A truffle.
Thank you, Joe. Good night, Marmee.
Amy.
I'm sorry for the things I said, Joe. And for you, Miss March, a petit four. A little squashed, but still edible.
Thank you.
Coming, Joe?
I just want to put the finishing touches on my story, Marmee.
Well, don't be too long and see that the fire is out.
no, 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 it can't be. No, no, Amy! Amy! Amy, where are you?
Joe, what's happening?
Amy!
Joe?
Amy, what have you done with my story?
Nothing.
Amy, I work day and night on this story. What did you do?
I burned it.
You won. And I'm glad I did. Choke you!
Joe, no!
Go on, I bare my throat to you.
Girls, what has gotten into you both?
She burned my story.
She deserved it.
Amy, you did what? And she did not deserve it! You have done an intolerable thing!
Marmy!
You destroyed what meant the world to Joe.
Joe has everything!
What do I have? A dress with scorch marks on the back? I have it. I write a story that my sister burned.
You could have given me the invitation.
That invitation was meant for me, Amy.
Your time will come, Amy.
No, my time will never come. I'm always forgotten. I'm always last. I'm never invited anywhere. I have nothing special.
Go to bed.
I hate the way I look. I hate this nightgown.
That nightgown was mine.
And I want something that's mine.
I'm so sorry.
It's not your fault, though, you did give birth to her.
Can't you see? She just wants to be like you. She wants to have what you have. She's just a child, Joe.
She's not a child, Mommy. She's a demon in a child's body.
If I could bring your story back, I would.
Those stories were everything to me, Mommy. They were my passion. They were everything that I lived for.
That passion is still in you. Believe me, Joe, it's still there.
I will never forgive her.
You're not wrong, Joe, to feel anger. But if you build a wall between you and Amy, the one person you may end up hurting is yourself. And I couldn't bear that. Try and get some sleep.
I can't sleep. I won't.
I will never fall asleep again. Not for decades, no, not even then. My life was in that story. How could she be so proud? How can so much be lost so easily? I wrote my heart out, it does not seem fair. I'll rage until I'm with her. I'll grow cold and bitter.
Madwoman in the attic. Spinster, rejected by the world, a creature of God. I like this. Her hair in golden braids.
Joe! Joe, come skating with me. The ice is magnificent today. The pond is still frozen enough. Joe, come!
I'm in the middle of writing a story, Laurie.
I'll finish it later. I want to win one race before the winter's over.
I'll give you a 2-minute head start.
2 minutes!
And I will still win!
Go with them.
Joe doesn't want me.
Go anyway.
She hasn't talked to me in 3 weeks. I drew a picture of her with her beautiful hair and she just ignored it. Besides, my ice skates don't fit me anymore.
Take mine.
Can I really? Thank you, Beth. I hope one day I can be sweet like you.
Arson.
Watch where you're going.
Sorry, Mr. Lawrence.
The piano sounds terrible.
It needs a tuning, sir.
Where is my grandson, Laurie?
I'm sure he'll be home soon.
The boy's missed 6 lessons and fallen behind in all his work. Strictly forbidden him to associate with this family.
Why, sir?
Because a man needs an iron will if he needs to succeed in this world, and this family will only soften him. Which one of the dreadful little March girls are you?
I'm Dreadful Beth.
Ah, yes. Laurie said you're the one who wants to play my priceless piano. Well, it's out of the question. That piano belonged to my daughter, Laurie's mother. It's been locked since she passed away, and that's how it shall stay. Are you afraid of me?
A little.
Why?
It might have something to do with your face, sir. It's very hard.
I cannot help my hard face. Continue what you were playing. Come now, I haven't all day. You going to play or not?
Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. We will buy dishes there, maybe even 2 cents. Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while on crepe Suzette's.
Well, go on.
We will build model boats off of Massachusetts, there in Massachusetts by the bay. Put them together and wait until the glue sets.
What's the matter now?
I don't remember the rest, sir.
While we wait, we'll poker for the folk along the parapets.
Off
to Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off
to where the shops are sweet. We'll play minuets off in Massachusetts, Boston, Massachusetts, Beacon Street. You say, come to see, off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go. Well, goodbye.
Goodbye, sir.
Come visit me tomorrow. I'll see if I can find the key to that old piano and see if there's still some music left in it. Will you come?
Yes.
And when you see my grandson, Laurie, tell him I wish to see him at once.
Meg! What is it, Beth? Mr. Lawrence was just here. He invited me to come to his house and play his piano.
Oh, Beth!
He's really not as horrible as we imagined.
Meg, Meg!
Amy,
it's
wrong?
Amy, she fell through the ice.
She was skating by the bridge and suddenly the ice gave way. I got her just in time.
She's careless, she's rash.
She just wanted to be with you.
I was skating so beautifully. You know you're not supposed to skate by the bridge. Everyone knows that the ice there is dangerous.
But you didn't want me skating near you. I love your stories, Joe. I tried to write one to make up for what I did, but I couldn't think of anything to say. So I drew a picture of you with your beautiful hair.
And my big mouth.
And you just ignored it.
If it wasn't for Laurie, you could have been killed.
Maybe it would have been better if I had.
You must never speak like that,
Amy. When you burned my story, I was devastated. I couldn't understand how you could do such a thing.
Then go on, Joe. Forgive her.
See how much she shames
her. See her sweet
I think she deserves another chance.
Everyone stop.
Amy, you must promise to never think of me as an enemy again, but a sister who loves you.
I promise, Joe.
The March sisters forever!
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 And Laurie, who saved Amy and made today possible.
I want to declare before everyone, before the world, that on this day of forgiveness and joy, that you, Theodore Lawrence III, who has valiantly lost all contests to me, I declare you our brother, the brother we never had.
Swear to us your greatest oath of loyalty, an oath as dazzling as your charms.
I swear I'll follow you like royalty.
From this day on, no matter what, for five or all for life,
we'll live like musketeers.
Together we'll prevail. We'll be five for all forever from now on.
Now each of us must swear for all eternity, our bond shall never be undone.
Nothing shall sever this fraternity. We'll always live and die as one.
Your battles will be mine.
We'll be fine for all forever from now on.
On this wonderful day.
It's wonderful.
I'll never forget. I am on
this
day. I am good.
happy birthday. From this day on, no matter what, we're five for all we're life. We'll conquer every foe
with our brother by our side.
And if you're not here, he'd be our brother too.
Megs in love.
We'll consider any friend.
We'll be loyal to the end.
We'll be five for all forever.
We'll be five for all forever.
We'll be five for all forever from now on and on.
Getting to the station.
Amy, darling, are you ready? Aunt March will be here soon.
You don't want to miss your train.
I'll need a few more minutes. I'm waiting for Joe. Tell me I'm doing the right thing.
You're doing the right thing.
I've never left my girls before.
Your husband has pneumonia and needs you with him in Washington.
I feel like I'm being torn in two. Part of me here, the other part.
I will look in on the girls every day.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence.
Just going to take this to the carriage. Ah, good morning, Beth.
Good morning, sir. I fixed you a basket of food. Thank you, Beth.
Amy's almost ready. She's packing up half the house.
Where's Joe? She should have been back by now. I sent her to Aunt March's hours ago.
I'll go look for her.
Mom, here's a shawl Father loves so much.
Larmy, please don't make me go to Aunt March's. It scares me. Everything's so old in it. I drew this picture of you with apple blossoms in your hair, the goddess of spring. It's for Father. Is he going to die?
No, Amy, I'll see to it that he recovers. Now go and get the rest of your things.
Marmy, I'm so sorry I'm late, but I do have the money.
Thank you, Joe. I know how hard it is for you to ask Aunt March.
Well, I didn't ask Aunt March. I couldn't. I went down to the town commons and tried to sell my story, but when I failed, I sold my hair.
Joe!
You're bald.
I'm not bald.
But your hair was your best feature.
Now, Marmy, you'll have enough money to have a safe trip down to Washington and stay with Father as long as she needs. Here, $27.25, and I threw in a few coins that I had stashed away of my own.
You shouldn't have done this, Joe. I'm so
disappointed.
Proud. It was a very courageous thing to do. Thank you, Joe.
The carriage is ready, Miss March. Joe, you look different.
Mrs. March, you must hurry if you want to make it to the station.
By next summer, I can guarantee every girl in Concord will be wearing her hair.
Lori.
Come, let me hold my girls.
We've never been parted before. I feel awful.
Amy!
Take care of everything, Marmy. Don't worry.
Make certain your husband recovers, my dear Margaret.
Yes, Aunt March, and thank you for taking Amy. Amy, tell Aunt March how excited you are.
I'm so excited to live with you on Marmy's in Washington.
Naturally.
No glum faces and no tears. I'll be back as soon as possible. How did you all grow up so fast?
Tell Father how much I miss him and love him.
Goodbye, Aunt March.
Josephine, what have you done?
I sold my hair so Marmy could have a safe trip to Washington.
You did what? I told you, if you need money, come to me.
I was hoping I could earn some money of my own.
Selling your hair and cutting it like a beggar? It's not an option for a lady. You look like a shorn sheep. Have you forgotten our contract?
Well, how could I forget it? Europe, London, Paris.
Well, you don't live up to your part of the bargain. Why should I live up to mine?
Oh, I have tried to live up to my part of the bargain. I have tried. I went to balls. I read books on etiquette. I practiced dancing with Meg, and I held my tongue in several situations where I just wanted to scream that I have a fire in me, Aunt March.
Well, see how far this fire will take you in life. See what doors this fire will open. See what society thinks of your fire.
Oh, to hell with society.
Josephine!
We don't live for society. We live for what's inside of us, our dreams, our passion.
That's enough, Josephine. And as for Europe, you can forget it.
Aunt March, please.
Europe is meant for someone with a little more understanding of its rewards.
No.
The subject is closed.
The subject is not closed. And if it is, open it up again. I will go to Europe. I will. I'll go if I have to swim there. Hello, John.
I like your haircut, Joe.
And my hair! My hair will grow back.
And who is this man? He's Laurie's tutor and a friend. Well, Tell your friend to make his visit brief. Amy, collect your things. I'll wait for you at the carriage. I have plans for you.
Yes, ma'am. John, what have you done?
I've enlisted. I couldn't stand by any longer. Your own father's in the Army Hospital in Washington. I have friends who will never return.
When do you leave?
Tonight. Meg. Margaret. I am not a rich man, and I'm not particularly handsome.
You're very handsome, John.
Really? I'm not the wisest man in the world.
You're very wise.
Thank you, Meg. Margaret. If you could find it in your heart, if you could love me as I love you, if only you'd care while we are apart, I could be rich. I could be wise. I could be more than I am. Imagine me here with you. If only you'll care if I carry on. And I could be strong.
Why must you go?
I could be brave.
Don't be too brave.
I could be more.
Oh, become home.
More than I am. If you will say you love me enough to marry me, I will come home and love you for all of my life. And I will be more than I am. Say yes, make me more than I am. With all my heart, I swear I will love you as you love me. From this moment on,
so we'll be apart. I will be more.
I will be more
than I am.
More than I am.
With you, I am more than.
I'll write you twice a day, five times a day.
It's settled. We'll all go to Europe.
What?
Well, why shouldn't we? We're all growing women. It's time we looked in the future. I'll get a real job. We'll save our pennies.
Joe.
I've already planned our itinerary. We'll go to Rome, Madrid, see the Vatican. It's a wonderful idea, isn't it?
Joe, I'm engaged. John proposed and I accepted.
Meg! Meg, that's so romantic! Engaged. Meg's engaged. Have a big wedding. Aunt March says they're very fashionable.
Okay. Amy, Aunt March is waiting for you. I'll come visit you soon.
Bye, everyone.
What about our promise to stick together?
We made that a long time ago, Joe. I've changed. You've changed.
I have not changed! I would never make a promise one day and break it the next.
No.
This is us we're talking about. Our word is everything.
Joe, I love him.
So you love him. This is us we're talking about. Our future as a family is at stake.
No.
You're turning your back on us.
I'm not turning my back on you.
Yes, you are. What about me becoming a famous writer and giving you everything you've ever dreamed of?
But she loves him, Joe. I do. With all my heart and soul.
I've lost Meg.
You haven't lost Meg.
I've lost my trip to Europe.
You'll get to Europe someday, Joe. I know you will. You can do anything. You can make the clouds disappear.
My sweet Beth, it's you who can make the clouds disappear.
Come, walk with me. Tell me about all your adventures today.
Well, I sold my hair.
Yes?
And I went to the town commons and I said, Joe March is here. Carlotta, the woman in the attic, a spinster rejected by the world.
Woman, a spinster in the attic, a creature of gall rejected by the world, hungry for blood, rose from the dark. Joe March! Her eyes beady red and her hair ghastly white. Joe, it's your best friend, Theodore Lawrence III! And her fingers clutched with rage as she went on into the wretched night.
Laurie, oh my goodness, it's wonderful to see you. I haven't seen you in weeks.
I was in Boston. I have dreadful news. With the war over, grandfather's insisted I get on with my life. He enrolled me in school.
Well, that's wonderful news.
What's wonderful about it? Leaving the best friend I've ever had?
Well, I couldn't imagine Concord without you, not seeing your wonderful smile every day.
I don't want to go.
But you've got to. It's college. It's a wonderful opportunity. Why, I'd go in a moment. I'd study everything.
What do you need of schools? You're going to be a famous writer. I need to tell you something.
What is it?
Ever since that first day I saw you, do you remember that day?
Well, of course.
The day you chopped down grandfather's cherished tree? I knew that you and I would be magnificent together.
We are magnificent together.
My sweet Joe, for weeks now, months even, the whole year actually, I've wanted to.
What was that?
A kiss?
Well, I know it was a kiss!
It was my first kiss. I thought about it a long time. You could do 100 things, do anything you please. We could go to such extremes. There's so much we could share.
No. What has gotten into you, Laurie?
Here, I took part of my inheritance and I bought you this ring.
Ring!
I want to marry you.
No, stop, this is not funny.
I love you, Joe, and I want you to be my wife.
You don't.
I do. I've practiced saying it over and over. Marry me, marry
You've
me!
You've gone mad!
I love you, Joe.
No, you don't. No, you don't love me. You want an accomplished girl.
I don't want an accomplished girl. I want you.
Well, you cannot have me.
At least say you'll think about it.
There's nothing to think about. I will never marry.
You don't mean that.
Yes, I do.
You'll marry.
I won't.
You will. Just not me. That's what you're really saying. You'll find someone.
Ever since we met, you always knew who I was, what I wanted. I bared my soul to you.
You knew all along how I felt. Everybody knew.
No! Please! Just go.
Joe, please.
No! Please, just go. It was he that's married me, with this ring and has married me, the nerve, the gall. Not what it was meant to be. How could he ruin it all with those two words? I thought I knew him, thought that he knew me. When did it change? What did I miss? A kiss, when I thought all along that we were meant to guard frontiers. How could I be so wrong? And I mean, how I need my sisters here. If I can't share my dreams, what were they for? Before, and I don't know how to proceed.
I only know I'm meant for something more. I've got to know if I can be astonishing.
March?
No, Miss Kirk, I have not seen the whereabouts of Miss March.
Helga, do we have enough sheets for the new boarders? Since the war ended, Professor, people are coming from everywhere. Miss March!
What is it, Miss Kirk?
Miss March received a telegram! A telegram, Professor! She may have inherited a great deal of money, she could be an heiress. Then again, it could be a terrible tragedy. There really is no telling, is there? I think as her good friend, you'd be concerned for her.
We are not good friends. We are simply acquaintances.
I see. Helga?
You and the others in this house are under the impression that Miss March and I have some sort of kinship. We simply go places together.
The theater?
Yes, I took her to see Hamlet.
A pathetic tale it is.
Very pathetic. And I've given her 3 German lessons.
3? That many?
And I've taken her to hear speakers and to the park. But Miss March hardly seems to know I exist. She's preoccupied. She rushes past me like the wind.
Mrs. Kirk! Oh, Mrs. Kirk, have you seen the professor?
He's right behind you, darling.
Oh, hello, Professor Guten Tag.
Guten Tag, Miss March. The word is Tag. Guten Tag means good day.
Well, I know what it means, but when you taught it to me, I could have sworn you said Guten Tag.
I would never say Tag.
Well, I'm sure you did.
Well, I'm sure I didn't.
Well, then, Guten Tag, Professor. It is a wonderful Guten Tag, was it? Guten Tag. It's a wonderful Guten Tag, a splendid Guten Tag. And I have some amazing news. I came to New York on a dream. I knew it might take me a while, but all I've been hearing since I arrived is leave it right there on the pile. So today I woke up, decided it's time. Time to achieve, time to thrive, time to climb.
Mark, tell us what happened.
Sometimes when you dream, your dream is just a guess. Sometimes when you work really hard, you don't know if you'll ever find success. So I grabbed a story to sell and got ready to raise hell. Then I marched out the door and I headed right for the Weekly Volcano Press.
Henry Dashwood, now he's a man of taste.
Dashwood was a fiend. He sneered at my distress. Tossed my story high on a stack, but I was determined I would progress. I said, sir, I'll wait while you read. But alas, he disagreed. So I jumped on a chair and I read it right there in the Weekly Volcano Press.
You did what?
Oh my.
Keep away from me, you wretch! I cannot keep away. Your beauty draws me, your passion ignites me!
Oh, it's the horror story, the bloodbath.
Yes, that's the one. But I took to heart what you said and I embellished. I made it better. Thunder claps, lightning strikes!
I've got to hold you.
I defy you.
I will take you.
Let me buy you. Let go. Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
Unhand that woman, villain. Who are you?
I am your destiny. Your betrayal is born. I've come to avenge.
To the forest!
I can't. The forest is dark and dangerous. My sister went in there and never returned.
You must risk it. You must take the dark path. Your fate awaits you there.
She will never escape me.
Hurry!
On God!
Go! Now!
Dashwood was aghast, but I could not care less. The words I spoke ignited the air. I felt like a publishing lion. That's when Dashwood started to shout, and I thought he'd throw me out. But then I persevered, and a fox appeared in the Weekly Volcano Press. Clarissa enters, trembling, fearful of what fate awaits her. She comes to a fork in the road where she can go no further. Which way do I go? A hag appears.
I can help you choose, but you must make a sacrifice. Give me something dear. These combs are nice.
Without these combs, what will I be?
Perhaps the hag is jealousy.
I can't.
You'll never know your destiny unless you give up vanity.
I have to know. Show me where to go.
Swamps. Her shoes tumble off. The sleeve of her dress gets caught on a twisted limb. She comes to wild rapids where she can go no further. A troll appears.
If you want to cross, you must pay me. I'm the only boat that can get you there alive. I see you wear a necklace that holds a pretty jewel. The price to get how its glitter makes me drool.
I've nothing left but this. My prospects are so bleak.
You'll never know what wisdom is until you give up all your riches.
Here, it's yours. Now show me distant shores.
I'll take you to your fate.
Amazing, and sometimes when you yearn, you burn the air, and someone else feels the flame you always knew was there.
ladies.
I cannot stop.
Can you not give a tired old knight some assistance?
I have nothing left to give.
Give me your time.
Can't. My fate awaits me.
Can you not care for me? It's been years since I held another hand.
And take mine. Oh. And take my shawl. Ragged as it is.
You have completed your journey. My sword is yours. It will protect you against your enemies. You can now return to the moors. Your fate is in your hands.
Orisa raced from the forest and raced to the moors where she screamed, I have returned, Braxton! I will free the moors of your tyranny! Fight me!
I knew you would return to me. They always do.
Orisa thrusts, she parries. Braxton up against a tree and pins him there. Her sword, so witching and swooshing, she leaps on a craggy rock. Never has she been so determined. She is on fire. Pity she hadn't taken dueling lessons. But who should return? But the long forgotten Rodrigo!
This is your end, villain. I've waited a lifetime to destroy you.
Who are you?
I am your worst nightmare, Braxton. I am her sister!
And then Dashwood got on his knees, crying, sell this to me, please.
This barge.
Then he ordered four more. Now I'm riding for the weepy volcano press. I'm ready for destiny. My dress is a purple. I'll take what is right in mine. With darkness of death. I will not quit. I won't be forgotten. I will shine in death.
Congratulations, I am...
amazed!
Flabbergasted and delighted.
Oh, I cannot believe it. I'm going to be a published writer. $15.25 more in my commission.
Oh, you're rich.
I feel rich. Oh, Professor, do you dance?
No.
Well, neither do I, but today I could. Oh, okay.
Miss March. Have you ever been to the Broadway Gardens?
Are you asking me to dinner, Professor?
No. Yes? Yes.
I should like that.
Miss March, I'd almost forgotten all the excitement this telegram arrived for you. More good news, I suspect.
Open it.
Oh, I will. I will. I feel as if today is anything as possible. I could start a revolution. I could.
What is it, Miss March?
Is it not good news?
Oh, dear God, no. No, it can't be. My sister Beth has contracted scarlet fever. I must go to her immediately.
I'm so sorry for you
Is
and your family.
Is there anything we can do?
No, no. No, but thank you both for everything. Mrs. Kirk, tell your girls.
They'll be fine.
Tell them to keep reading.
I will.
Miss March.
Yes.
I should like to accompany you.
Accompany me?
You should not travel alone.
I traveled here alone. I'm not afraid, but thank you. Thank you both for everything.
Miss March?
Yes?
You will return.
Well, of course.
Oh, and Miss March. Viel Glück.
Thank you. Yes, thank you. I shall need the good luck.
Your simple acquaintance is leaving you. Oh, Mr. Felix, feet off the sofa!
heavy piece of wood, isn't it?
Light as a feather, sir.
Beth knows nothing.
She always sees everything.
There, that's it.
Yes.
At last it's found a home.
It's a beauty, sir. I'll let Joe know.
John, wait, the flowers.
Right.
It's magnificent, Mr. Lawrence. But you shouldn't have.
But I did, and enough said on the matter.
Joe!
She's ready.
It's in place.
Meg? Beth?
Here she is. Where are you taking me?
You'll see.
Is it Amy? Is she back?
No, it's not Amy. She's not back.
Well, what is it?
Patience. There.
Mr. Lawrence.
Over here.
Your piano.
No, Beth. Yours.
Mine? Marmee, no. There was no arguing with him. But why, sir?
Because it kept asking, where is that dreadful little March girl? It missed you.
Sit up, Beth.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence. I shall treasure it. Play something for us, Beth. It sounds good.
Oh, I forgot to tell you. I received a letter from Laurie this morning. He had been in New York.
Laurie was in New York.
Didn't he come see you?
No.
Sorry, but he was moping about for weeks. I insisted he do some business for me and then go to Europe and enjoy himself. And guess who he met up with in Florence?
Who?
Amy and your Aunt March. Miss March, may I join you?
It would be an honor, sir.
If you say come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go.
We will buy dishes there, maybe even two sets.
Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while on Crepe Suzette's.
I miss New York.
Off to Massachusetts, yes, we're off to where the shops are sweet. We will have no regrets off in Massachusetts.
Dear Professor Bear, I've been meaning to write to you. Oh, so much has happened. My sister Meg is having a baby. Beth is very frail, but I know I have it in me to help her to get better. I've decided to take her and Marmee down to Cape Cod for a few days to found it. In spite of all that's happened, I don't know when I'll be able to return to New York. But I miss it. I miss our volatile exchanges. I miss our walks to the park to see speakers that would someday change the world. I, too, would like to change the world.
Change the world. Yes, of course. And how are you, sir? Asks how I am, and so how am I. My days are the usual days. I wake up, I go out, time goes by. My days are exactly the days I have lived since arriving here. In fact, how I am is amazed how this comforts me year by year. I work and I eat. Life is cheese and jam. The house is nice and quiet now. That is how I am. 5 years in these rooms, reading Hegel and Kant. My mind is devoted to thoughts of the meaning of life. What more could I want? So why is it lately I feel I'm uneasy all through the night? Why, even now, does my skin feel explosive as dynamite? Why does my heart pound, battering around? Now how can she ask me how I am? How I am is fine. Dear Miss March, there is nothing dramatic or new to report. This will be short. Morning and evening, I live in my usual way. On the day you return, you will see for yourself. Tell me, Miss March, are you happy so far from the clang and the beat of our turbulent street? Quite often I think of our days in New York. Though, of course, since you went, I have been quite content. I wake in the morning and all that I hear is the absence of sound. Yes, my peace is disturbed, but the ruckus is me as my thoughts run aground. I wanted a life by myself in these rooms, but now all around me another life looms. Who asked her to come and to go and to leave me like that? And now she expects me to send her a note with words if I spoke that would stick in my throat. Who asked her to change how I live and how I think? How I am. How can I reply? I go through my daily routine. I give lessons, I wait. Time goes by. Yet lately I find there is pleasure in humming a simple tune. Some days I go to the park and I sit there all afternoon. How I am.
Marmee, it's so beautiful. All the waves and the shells.
I believe this one's 1,000 years old. Listen, Beth. Remember how we always talked about coming to Cape Cod?
And now Jo, with her wee literary earnings, as she calls it, has brought us.
I'm so happy to be here with you. Promise me, Beth, whatever's got a hold of you, you'll continue to fight it.
Beth, look what I brought for you. A kite. Look at the backing. I told the man that I wanted the sturdiest kite for my sister.
This is the most beautiful kite I've ever seen.
I shall leave you two.
Stay.
No, stay.
I'll write a letter to Father to tell him how wonderful the Cape is this time of year. I love you.
Love you. Oh, Beth, this is a dream come true. Come, help me put the kite together.
Tell me again about New York.
New York? Well, it's a circus.
A circus?
Yes, with clowns waltzing horses, and theaters. They're everywhere, Beth.
And the women, are they shameless?
Some of them, anyway. I'm going to take you there someday.
To New York?
Yes, and we'll dine at the finest restaurants, see Shakespeare, ride in the omnibus, and mingle with the unsavory characters.
Jo, I have something for you.
Yes.
Marmee says this shell is over 1,000 years old, and I believe that once upon a time it had an amazing life. If you put it up to your ear, it talks to you.
And what does it say?
It says, we grow up too fast. You're a woman of the world now, Jo. I'm so proud of you.
When you were first born, not even an hour old, I told Marmee,
Beth is mine!
We all have someone special in the world, and I have you. My sweet Beth, give me a task to do.
Let's pretend we're riding on a kite. Let's imagine we're flying through the air.
We'll ascend until we're out of sight. Light as paper, we'll soar.
Let's be wild. Enjoy the view.
sky that's bright and blue, and some things will never end. The thrill of our match fight, the love that I feel inside for you. We'll climb high.
Every bump in the road.
One should always be civil. The coachman, Amy. You must respect those who have the reins before you wrench the reins from their hands.
You're right, Aunt March. Marmy? Joe? Meg?
And remember, Amy, you are a lady now.
Yes, I'm a lady. When did this house get so small?
As we grow grand, Amy, the world often diminishes around us. I've known people to disappear before my very eyes.
You're such a dear, Aunt March. Thank you for everything.
I'll go see to that wretched coachman.
Remember, Aunt March, respect those who have the reins.
Very good. Amy?
Meg! Meg, Meg! Is it really you?
Marmy! Oh, let me look at you. You're beautiful.
Let me look at you. You're a mother now. Twins. I can't believe it.
Neither can I.
Marmy!
Amy, my baby is home.
Marmy, look at her. You're all grown up.
I am, Marmy. I really am. I feel older. I'm sophisticated. You can't imagine all the experiences I had. And wherever I was, I think, if only Meg were here. If only Joe. If only Beth.
Amy.
I was so sad I wasn't here to say goodbye to her.
I cried for weeks. I couldn't stop. On March said I was being unreasonable, but my heart was breaking not to be here with her.
Beth understood.
Joe!
She said to tell Amy not to fret.
Did she really say that?
Yes. She was so brave until the very end. You would have been so proud of her.
I bought her this metronome. The man said there wasn't another like it. Where did we get that magnificent piano?
Mr. Lawrence gave it to Beth.
He's such a dear, isn't he? It's so good to be home in our dear house.
Amy, show us the things you brought back.
It's a king's ransom. You can't imagine all the places I went. I ate frogs, actual frogs. And how's John? Is he still romantic?
More so.
Men are so amazing.
It's almost everything.
Laurie, I hadn't realized you were sailing back on the same ship.
Yes, we all sailed on the same ship.
Well, Laurie, so good of you to comfort Amy and Aunt March and our loss of Beth.
When I heard the news, I was devastated. I didn't come to see you when I was in New York.
No, what I said was so unfeeling.
You said what you felt.
No, I didn't.
You look different, you know. Very distinguished.
Distinguished. Thank you. I've missed you.
I've missed you, too. You know, Joe, I've learned something about myself.
And what is that?
I was never meant to fly on golden wings.
Oh, who is?
You, Joe, you were. Me, I was meant for more mundane things. I've decided to go into grandfather's business. I know it's the last thing in the world I would have thought for myself, but the truth is I'm fascinated with the prospects. I shall be wily and shrewd.
Laurie.
Amy, did you tell Joe?
Tell me what?
The most amazing thing.
Really quite a thing.
You tell her.
No, you tell her.
All right, I'll tell her. We were under the bridge of sighs.
Gondola.
Under Italian skies.
She was singing lullabies.
He says he likes the way I sing.
The day was ours.
We talked for hours.
It was amazing.
I love fireflies.
I said so do I.
I told him I hate goodbyes.
There was something in her eyes.
I swear the bells began to ring.
We found that we
were so alike. It was amazing.
Well, all right. Tell me. Who proposed to who?
You know? We were trying to be discreet about
amazing. It. Amazing. There we were in Venice.
In a gondola.
Will you marry me?
It was so romantic.
And then I fell into the water.
And before we even knew it,
she dove in and rescued me.
It happened before we knew.
How could we have known?
Amazing what time can do.
From that moment, my heart grew.
We'll be married in the spring. In all the world we'd fall in love, and yet we did. It was amazing.
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 The most amazing thing.
Come, Laurie, help me with the rest of my things.
She bought half of Europe.
And I'll buy the other half on my next trip. Oh, and later on, March wants to talk to us about proper wedding etiquette.
Well, Laurie, welcome to the family.
Thank you, Joe.
I never meant for it to end up like this. I'd always thought of Laurie as yours.
Amy, Laurie was never mine. Laurie was always one of us.
Oh, I brought you this. It's a book of my drawings. It's all the things I thought you should have seen. Mountains, palaces. I want you to have them.
Amy, I can't.
Yes, you can, Joe. We'll be close. That will never change.
Thank you. Thank you, Amy. Your drawings are beautiful.
Thank you.
been up here.
Yes.
This room
I know.
Great. And a dusting.
Yes, I'll get to it.
The attic used to be such a sanctuary for you. Whenever you were sad or disappointed, you'd run up here, bolt the door, and come back hours later so full of life. I haven't seen that Joe in a long time.
Something I was always good at that, and Beth used to say I could make the clouds disappear, but I want Beth back!
Joe,
if Beth was here, everything would have been different.
Joe, you could not have changed what happened.
How do you do it? How do you go day in and day out like nothing has happened?
You think that's how I go on?
You're so strong! How can I be like you? How can I gain that strength?
Don't make so much of me, Joe. I never dreamed of this sorrow. I never thought I'd have reason to lament. I hoped I'd never know heartbreak. How I wish I could change the way things went. I wanted nothing but goodness. I wanted reason to prevail. Not this bare emptiness. I wanted days aplenty, but I refuse to feel tragic. I am aching for more than pain and grief. There has got to be meaning. Most of all, when a life has been so brief, I've got to learn something. How can I give her? I want life to go on. I want days of plenty. You have to believe there is a reason for hope. You have to believe the answers will come. You can't let this defeat you.
Gathered here until we came ourselves. together, the four of us forever side by side. Everything I promised was for them. I was theirs, no matter where I went. How can that be lost forever? How, when I gave everything with all my heart?
Madonna.
Merci, John. It was all Lori's idea to have our wedding in our very petite maison, and I can deny mon amour nothing.
Why is she speaking French?
Was I that silly at our wedding?
Worse.
John.
You were inspiring.
John, Father telegram, he said he'd be at the station at noon. You must go fetch him.
3 sets of silver, 2 sets of dishes, 16 chairs, 4 cut glass bowls, and all the flowers from my conservatory. I've joyfully been divested of all my worldly possessions.
Where's Amy?
Oh, you must not see her before the wedding.
I know. Grandfather, here's the champagne you asked for.
I'll take it. I'm off to the train station.
Ah, come, let's have a cigar together before the ceremony begins. So how do you feel? Ready to be a bridegroom?
My life has never been more complete. And the rain is held up.
Where
is Josephine?
I'll go find her.
And tell Amy I wish to speak to her about receiving line etiquette. We have the cream of Concord Society coming any moment.
And March, I was told you wanted to speak with me.
I suppose you realize this could have been your day.
Ah, so you think I made a ghastly mistake?
I do not. Amy and Lori are ideally suited together. I've gone over my will.
Your will?
Meg will get most of the money. Amy is making her way in society and won't need any of it. And as for you...
Oh, I don't want it.
I know you don't want anything, and yet you want everything. Listen, Josephine. When times are bleak, every girl, every woman needs something to fall back on. I'm leaving you my house.
Your house?
Do something worthwhile with it. Make it a school or a library.
Thank you, Aunt March. That's very generous of you.
Oh, I do not like that dress.
It was yours.
Well, it looked better on me.
Joseph, there's a strange man at the front gate asking for you.
Professor Bear.
Hello.
Hello. Well, this is a surprise.
I know. You wrote, if I should ever come north, I should come visit you. Well...
Yes, but I never thought you would ask.
Come. Here I am. Should I go?
No.
Am I not intruding?
No, you're not intruding. Oh, how rude of me. Come inside, I'll introduce you.
No, not yet.
So... How's Mrs. Kirk?
As impossible as ever.
Mm-hmm. And the boarders?
As strange as ever.
Mm-hmm. And you?
Me?
Yes.
The same.
Well, you look...
Old, I know. Nearly 50.
No, you're only 34.
35.
Oh, you had a birthday.
They made a party for me. I got sick. I do not like parties. Oh, it was so good of you to send this book to me. Your manuscript. A novel.
Yes, well, there's no one whose opinion I appreciate more.
I felt your spirit. I heard your voice on every page. It was magnificent.
No, Amy is driving me insane. Oh, excuse me.
This is my sister Meg. This is Professor Bear.
I recognize you now from your sister's books.
Oh. You're the one she lets read it.
Yes, I will be there in a moment.
I have come at a bad time.
Oh, no. It's just a wedding.
A wedding?
You know, I often think of you, Professor. And I wonder how you're doing.
I bought a kite.
You bought a kite?
And I took it to the park. I never had a kite before. You know, you were right to think I was old. I was old.
No, you weren't.
No, I was, but since we met, everything's changed. Everyone's noticed, my students even. They say, Professor Bear, you're smiling today, Miss March.
Joe.
We are not at all alike. We have our differences, but... May I be blunt?
Yes. Be blunt, by all means.
I think perhaps it looks like rain.
The sky gets bluer by the hour.
The water falls in little drops.
That's why it's called a sun shower.
Ah, and now it stops.
Yes, you were about to be blunt.
If I say rain, then you say sun. If I say yes, then you say no. It seems before we start, we're done. We even argue at hello. If I say share with me this small umbrella.
I say who cares if we get wet?
We'll be as different as the morning and the night.
No, we're as different.
Always seem to fight. laugh, you make me care. How can I explain inside my heart? I feel a pain when you're not there. Though we are not at all alike, you make me feel alive. If we had that in common, that one small thing in common, love could be like a small umbrella.
Josephine!
Christopher Columbus!
The guests will arrive any moment. I want the family in the parlor. Just who are you?
Edmarch, this is Professor Bear.
Call me Fritz.
Fritz? Your name is Fritz?
Did I never tell you?
Well, bring in Fritz.
You were saying Fritz.
When people discover passion, they've come upon something rare. This fervor they have in common will shelter them anywhere. Though the rest may be rough, with such passion to share, I think they have more than enough, enough to make a marriage if we dare. No. Yes. Yes. I mean, not today, or tomorrow, or next week. A year, 2 years, maybe.
I won't be sweet, won't be demure.
This I prefer, this I adore.
I'll speak my mind, you can be sure.
I'll be enchanted to the core.
If I say share with me the small umbrella,
I'll say if we get wet,
we'll be as different as a husband and a wife.
No, we'll be as different as a woman and a man.
We'll fight our way through life.
We'll disagree the best we can.
And yet, you make me smile.
You make me care.
How can I explain inside my heart? I feel a pain when you're not there.
Though we are not at all alike, you make me feel alive.
If we had that in common,
that one small thing in common,
love could be like a small umbrella in the rain.
I have amazing news for you.
Yes.
I showed your novel to Henry Dapp.
You did what?
No, it was wrong of me, but I couldn't resist. Horrid man Dashwood, stubborn.
Well, what did blunt. He say?
Well, he liked it. He said it was a bit long. He missed the blood and guts, but he particularly liked the four sisters, especially the outspoken one. He wants to publish it.
He said that!
Well, if you like.
Joe, we need you inside.
Marmy! This is my good friend, Professor Bear.
Welcome, Professor. Come and meet our family.
Sometimes when you dream, your dreams come true in extraordinary ways. Suddenly a day.
Waiting for you inside.